Welcome to the Research Like a Pro with DNA question and answer series. Today, we are talking about how can I use GWorks at DNAGedcom to find possible ancestors. So GWorks is a tool available at DNAGedcom.com, not to be confused with the DNAGedcom client, which is used to gather DNA matches and is a program you download to your computer. DNAGedcom.com is a website. So this tool is used on the website. So like I said, it's an online tool at DNAGedcom, and the G in GWorks stands for GEDCOM. And this is basically a tool to allow you to compare ancestors from trees of DNA matches that are contained within GEDCOM files or the A or ancestor files downloaded by DNAGedcom client for one of your test takers kits. So for example, if I tested Ancestry, then all of my DNA matches at Ancestry, some of them have family trees attached to them. The DNAGedcom client can download all of their trees and make a list in a CSV file of every single ancestor from that tree. And then it creates a very huge A file, ancestor file, that you can then load into GWorks to try to find patterns among surnames, try to find specific people that you think could be your candidate for the parents of your ancestor, and all kinds of other uses. So what is this A file? Well, like I said, the DNAGedcom client is a program on your computer that can download the trees of your DNA matches from testing companies. And currently at this time in April 2024, the DNAGedcom client is undergoing some revisions and doesn't work right now. But if you have previous A files that you've downloaded in the past, or hopefully in the future, you can continue to download them. You can use those. But what it does is it generates a spreadsheet or a CSV file where each row in the file is an ancestor from one of the DNA matches trees. So it will have, let's say that I have 20 people in my tree, starting with myself, my parents, my grandparents, going back. Then it will create 20 rows, starting with myself, my parents, my grandparents, and each one of those people has a tree. So it's just listing them out in order with their birth date, and actually doesn't include marriage date. I should have removed that, but it has only birth and death dates and places in the row for that person. It also lists the name of the DNA match who has that person in their tree. So here's an example of what this A file or ancestor file looks like. It's going to have the test ID in the first column, the match ID. And so the test ID is the person whose DNA kit you're looking at. So this would be my test ID. So it's gonna be the same for the whole column. Then the match ID would be the match. So the first match only has like 5 people in this tree and they're all private except for one. And then the next match has one person in their tree and it's private. And then the next match right here has a lot of people in their tree with a lot of names. So this is a great tree. So you can see that it's just a list of all of the matches and their ancestors. So what you can do with that file after you get it from DNAGedcom is go to the DNAGedcom.com website, and you'll see along the top of the website these different menu items. And the first thing you would do is create a free account so that you can save your work and come back to it. And then you go to the DNA kits and you're going to upload the GWorks files. Of course, you'll need the A file that I've been talking about, and you also need the M file, which is a list of all of the matches, and it has the link to the match pages for each of you and your matches, which GWorks then uses to allow you to click on that link when you see an ancestor of interest and go to the match page. So you have to get that file as well, and then after you load them here under DNA kits, you go to the GWorks menu item and you go to manage, and then you have to do this one more processing step to match the M file with the A file. Then after you've done that, it takes a while, maybe like 10 minutes or something. Then you can go to the GWorks section right here to the search the tree files. And that's what I usually use, but there are some other options like a surname report and compare tree files and things like that. So here's the screenshot of creating a new account. This is what it looks like. One thing that's interesting about this is for every kit that you want to analyze, you need to create a new account. So for the email address, you have to add like a unique email address. So I was just using my email and then adding a dash and then putting a number after it. And it doesn't actually email you. It's just required for creating another account. So if you have a lot of test kits that you manage, you have to put in kind of these like email aliases to create additional accounts. And if you don't create a new account for each kit that you analyze GEDCOM files for, it will overwrite the previous one. So it's up to you how you want to do that. I just create multiple. After you got your account, you can go to DNA Kits, click Upload DNA GEDCOM GWorks Files. You will then add your matches file here and your A file or ancestor file here. And those are created by the DNA GEDCOM client. And then you can go to GWorks and click Manage Tree Files. And then you have to click Match GEDCOM Files. And while you do it, you'll see this wait spinner, and then it will take about 10 or 15 minutes or so. And then you should definitely click on the instructions. You can view these instructions before you even try DNAGedcom GWorks. And so just go to dnagedcom.com/docs, and then you'll choose GWorks. So after you've done the managing of the tree files, you can see the other options here. I like to use the search tree files, and it gives you this page right here that you can use to filter and sort and search through all of the ancestors from all of your DNA matches. And you can imagine this is an enormous database because we have between 50 and 100,000 matches at Ancestry, most of us. So this can be a huge list. So here's the file name, which is actually the name of the DNA match. And it started off with a bunch of blank ones. That's why you can see the ANC for Ancestry. But this match has this person in their tree, and this is the birth and the death date and the birthplace and the death place. So what can you do with the search tree files? Well, first of all, you can't do anything quickly because it's very slow, and that's fine, but maybe just have something else to do at the same time so that while you're waiting, you can not be bored. But it does seem a little bit frozen while it's working. So just know that it might seem like nothing's happening, but just wait about 30 seconds and then your search result will be there. So one of the benefits, well, the main benefit of this is that it's a powerful and flexible way to use Boolean search filters on these ancestors. If you've ever tried searching through the surnames and places in Ancestry's database, it's not as easy. You can type in a surname, then you get a list of matches who have that surname in their tree. Then you click on the match and you go to their tree and you have to try to find where in their tree do they have that surname. So it's really kind of clunky. So it also takes a lot of time. So this one takes a lot of time, but when you get it done, the result is very amazing and helpful. So the fields, like I said, are surname, given name, sex, birth date, death date, birthplace, and death place. And the Boolean searches that you can do are no filter. And so you have to do that to clear out a search you've done. Contains, where it shows the records which contain the keyword. Does not contain, so you don't want to see that name. Starts with, so if you know the surname will start with a certain string of letters, but you don't know how it will end because of spelling variants, you can do that one. Ends with, same, but for the end, equal to, you want it to exactly match the keywords you put in, not equal to, greater than, you can use this for dates, less than, greater than or equal to, less than or equal to, is empty, and not is empty. So those are the Boolean search fields that you can use, filters you can use. And here's an example of one that I did. I just blurred out the names of the matches in the file name column. But you can see that I searched for the surname Dyer. So I type in Dyer to this box under surname, and then you click the filter button, and then the list pops up with all the Boolean terms I just showed you. And so I selected contains. So any row that contains Dyer within it. Then I clicked on the given name box, and then you can see that it's now sorting these in order. And so it's not that useful when you have like all these different names, but if you have 10 instances of James and you want them all to be grouped together like this, so I sort. And to sort, you can just click on the column header. You can also group, and you can do that by dragging on the column header and dropping it up here. But if you just click on given name, then it will sort all the names from A to Z. Then we have the gender, the birth date, and the death date. And then here you can see that I filtered my list because I had a really long list of all the Dyers that had the surname Dyer, but I only wanted to see ones that were born in Granger County, Tennessee. So I typed in Granger to birthplace and used the search filter of contains. So any birthplace that contains the word Granger County is now included in this list. So now I can see there's about 10 to 12 DNA matches here that have a Dyer who is born in Granger County. And I can further analyze these by opening up the DNA matches and seeing, do they fall within the right cluster, or do the shared matches that they have look like they're actually on the Dyer line, or are these just random Dyers in their tree that aren't related to my test taker on his Dyer line? So you have to do that extra step to make sure they're in the same cluster that you'd expect them to be, because people have a lot of individuals in their tree, and not all of them are related on the line we're looking into. Here's another example of how I filtered it. So I did the surname Dyer still, but then I cleared out the filter for Granger County and put in the filter of Georgia. So one of my YDNA matches for the Dyer line, his line goes back to Georgia and gets stuck. So I wanted to see if there's any Dyer matches from Georgia that might be useful. So I put in Georgia, then I'd used contains, and then I got all this list of ancestors who are in Georgia, and it's still sorted by given name. So now I can see there's two people named Elisha Samuel in two different individuals' trees, and there's two Mary E's from two different people's trees, and then there's this Mildred Logan Millie Dyer from two people's trees. So I've got some things I could follow up on. It's exciting to see an individual who's in more than one person's tree. I would like to see it in like 10 of the people's trees, but if it's just in two, that's still interesting and helpful. So it's a lead to follow. And so that's exciting. So that's how I use it with the A file generated from DNAGedcom client. Now, if you don't have an A file from the DNAGedcom client, you can still use GWorks. What you will need to use is the 1-2-Tree browser extension for Chrome. It allows you to kind of generate a GEDCOM file from looking at an open tree page on the Chrome browser, like in Ancestry. So you just open the tree page, click the browser extension for 1-2-Tree, and then you can click Save the GEDCOM file. Here's what the browser extension looks like in the Chrome Web Store. It has a bright pink logo. And you can add it to Chrome and use it for free, but it will only capture up to 4 generations. So to use the full functionality of this, you will need to purchase a subscription, which I think was $7 or $9. And it was in European currency. So I can't remember the exact exchange, but something very small and affordable. So then you go to a tree page, make sure you're on the actual tree and not the DNA match page, but click into the actual tree that looks like this. Then you'll click up here on the browser extension for 1-2-Tree. When you've done that, you will see the 1-2-Tree list of ancestors, and then you can click Save List as a GEDCOM file. Then once you do that, you can give it the name of the DNA match so that you can remember where it came from. And then one step that I didn't mention, when you click this button, the first time you do it, it opens up a page that has kind of the terms and services, and it opens up this page. So if you don't see this, you see like a terms and services thing. Just notice that you have two of these browser pages open. Anyway, when you do that, after you've looked at the terms and service, the next time you click this, it will ask you how many generations of the tree do you want? And it defaults to 12. You can increase it or decrease it depending on your preferences. I just try to get as many as possible, so I always increase it to 16. And then after you save it, you can then upload those GEDCOM files. So let's say that you have a cluster of DNA matches that you found that are all interesting, and maybe 10 of them have GEDCOM files that include, you know, over 20 people. You want to take all those GEDCOM files and compare them to each other and find common ancestors. One way to help you do that would be to use GWorks. So you can save all of those GEDCOM files, then upload them to GWorks. So you can do that by going to GWorks and clicking upload GEDCOM files. You'll see kind of some directions here. You just select multiple files at once here and then upload them. Then you have to go back to manage the tree files and press that button again to process and match them. And then when you're done, you can go to search tree files. And this time I'm showing you what it looks like when you click compare all your trees. And it shows you the most common occurrences of an ancestor within the trees of the matches. So if you're doing like an adoptee research project, you can see like, okay, here's some ancestral couples that are probably in their tree because these are like the most common. And I recognize these all from my test taker's tree. These are all in his tree and some of them are kind of far back because you have more matches for your more distant ancestors. But that's how this one works. And then when you click on this little expand button, then you can see the top like 10 matches that have that person in their tree. You can also see there's 93 matches with Ruth Arnold in their tree. So you can sometimes for like just scanning to see if there's certain surnames in a file, you can type in that surname that you're looking for and then see how many occurrences there are. If there's 0 or 1, that's not very good. But if there's like 20 or 30, then that's pretty good. You can actually do that with the surname occurrences. That would probably be better because this one is actually individuals. So as you can see, there's kind of a few different options that are helpful for when you have a hypothesis that you kind of want to see if there's any matches who match that hypothesis. And this can be really helpful with female maiden names and surnames for a tree going back in time. You want to see if your line attaches into that line that you found, and then you can check against this. When you open up this little arrow down, you can see the list of some of the people who are having that ancestor in their tree. All right, so that was an overview of how you can use GWorks to help you when you're comparing a lot of GEDCOM files or using the A file that's from DNAGedcom. So good luck if you decide to try GWorks.